to all of you and welcome to the National Law School of India University. My name is Dr. Neetu Sharma and I work with Center for Child and the Law as Program Head Right to Food in the National Law School. Today I'm going to talk to you about right to food as a human right. In terms of the contents of this module, we are going to look at the theoretical and conceptual framework. That means what do we understand by right to food? Why do we need to talk about right to food? What is the status in India and across the world when we are talking about the realization of right to food? What are the associated concepts as regards right to food, food security, hunger, malnutrition that we talk about? And what are the various components of right to food? After the conceptual framework, we are going to discuss about right to food in law, especially as regards international legal framework as well as domestic legal framework in India. In India, we are going to look at constitutional provisions, national nutrition policy, National Food Security Act, role of judiciary in evolving the jurisdiction on right to food, as well as various schemes and programs that are there in India on realization of right to food and ensuring food security for all. When we talk about right to food, this is a very simple term and we understand that everybody should have enough to eat. But when we go into the technicality of right to food, we understand that there are certain definitions that encompass and then encapsulate the content of right to food. Food and Agricultural Organization of the United Nations has defined right to food as access to food at all times for all men and women and children individually or in community and with good quality and quantity. That means there are certain components that need to be defined as integral part of right to food. And if any of these components are missing from the conceptual, normative or the actual operationalization of right to food, it means the right to food is being violated. The components of right to food can be defined as its availability, its access, adequacy, absorption and utility, continuity, dignity, as well as right to water. Now, all these seem to be very simple terms, but while talking in greater detail about it, we will understand that all these means a lot, especially for poor people, for children, and for vulnerable groups. Even for those who have regular access to food in all times may get subjected to the violation of right to food. Talking about the availability, we understand that food should be available, food grains should be available in all times. That means there should be enough production by country, by various states of food and food grains. That also means that if states and countries are not really producing enough food, they should be able to import enough food or should be able to distribute, or the state should be able to distribute food grains and various other commodities that are related to the to provision of food to all the states and to the entire country. We also know that only availability of food in any place, it's not going to solve the problems, because food should also be accessible. That means anybody who is staying at any part of the country or in a state should be able to access food and food grains. Now, one will think why we are not able to access food grains when it is available, or it is available in good quality or in greater quantity. There could be several occasions or several reasons that prevent anybody to access food even if it is available. For instance, if one person is located in a remote place or in a rural area where food grains cannot be supplied, or there is disaster or there is a natural calamity because of which the supplies cannot be sustained. These are the reasons because of which a physical access to food can be prevented. For a person who is disabled also may not be able to go and get his food or food grains. So in addition to physical access to food, other reasons could be, say, social or economic access. Economic access means that everybody should be able to access physically as well as be in a position to buy food that means should have enough purchasing power to buy food and food grains. So, for poor people who do not have enough money or who do not have enough cash, may not be able to buy food, and that would mean they do not have economic access to food. There is a third kind of access that could be a complicated one, which is a social access to food. Now, when we are talking about social access to food, we mean that all groups, whether it is social groups, whether it is religious groups or caste groups, they should have equitable access to food. You may have heard that there are discrimination meted out to children within families and households, especially when they are girl children and boy children. A female child is perhaps given either less food or fed last to ensure that boys in the family get enough food. Now, this is a violation of social access to food. Similar conditions may exist when a particular caste in a village is not able to access the water resources in the village as much as the other castes do. So, we know that there are barriers in access to food, and these can be of multiple forms. Third important component of right to food is the adequacy. Now, it may seem like a simple term, but adequacy in terms of food is a loaded term. Adequacy in terms of quantity is the first thing. That means that I should be able to eat enough food which is required for my sustenance, as well as for me to grow if I'm a child, and should be able to lead a healthy life. This quantity also means that I should eat enough calories, and it should be available in the form that I am used to of eating. Now, these calories have been defined by nutrition experts in India. Indian Council of Medical Research has given detailed guidelines on how many calories a person who does moderate work, an adult, a female, a male, and children of different age groups are supposed to consume in a day. So if I do not get enough calories and enough quantity of food, my right to food gets violated. So that is the first form of adequacy of food. Going further, we must also ensure that there should be enough or sufficiently good quality of food that we are eating. That means food should be safe, there should not be any contamination, and the quality in terms prescribed by the Food Safety and Standards Authority of India should be met. So that means that if I am eating enough quantity of food, that is taking care of my hunger, but the quality of food is either not safe or is not up to the mark as described by Food Safety and Standards Authority of India, my right to food gets violated. Third important component of adequacy in terms of right to food is provision of nutritional value in the platter of food that we are eating. That means that my food or my calories that it's coming from should have a diverse source. Meaning that, so in addition to quality and quantity that we are talking about, we should also make sure that the food is also good and adequate in terms of nutritional value. That means that I should be able to eat enough food in terms of adequate carbohydrates, adequate protein that I need, adequate vitamins, whether it is vitamin A, B, C, or any other vitamins that have been prescribed by the nutrition experts, and other micronutrients such as iron, folic acid, and other nutrients that are supposed to be in the food. Now, that will happen only when I eat food from diverse sources, so that I have carbs coming from calories, I have fats coming in from different sources, and water content and other nutrients that are required for the body to absorb. It is important because at various stages of our life, we need different quantity as well as diversity of food that we should consume. It is very important, for instance, for children to consume enough proteins. It is very important for adolescent girls to have enough folic acid and iron content in their body that they should be able to absorb. Similarly, in growing age, say in pregnancy and later in their life, women need enough calcium. So when we are talking about nutrient value and diversity. That means that the nutritional needs of people, of human beings at all stages of their lives are met, and they are able to eat enough and sufficient quantity from diverse sources of food. Another important, a very critical aspect, and perhaps a bit complicated too, is the cultural acceptability of food. This means that if I am eating food which is good in quantity, which is of good quality, which has nutrition value and it is available to me, is not sufficient unless it is the kind of food that I am used to of eating traditionally. You may have heard that people in coastal areas used to of consuming more of seafood, so their staple diet may be fish. People in South India consume more of rice, so they are more used to eating rice for their meals. In North India, people like eating wheat. In various states of India, being a big country, for instance Rajasthan, people eat millets, especially bajra. In south of Karnataka, people are used to eating ragi. So these are the staples that people are used to eating. There is another distinction with regard to culture, which comes from the non-vegetarianism and vegetarianism. There are people who are traditionally vegetarian, there are people who are traditionally non-vegetarians. So when we are talking about the realization of right to food for all, we must also know that their right to food is also contingent on how the food and in what form the food is being made available to them. If I am a vegetarian, I should be able to consume vegetarian food. If I am a non-vegetarian, I should have a choice to have non-veg food as my staple. So these are all the aspects when we are talking about the adequacy of food. Next, when we talk about when a person or a child is able to get that quantity or quality of food, it is also required that the body of that person is able to absorb and utilize the nutrients and the nutrient value that is coming from that food. Now, how that will happen? How is that we can ensure? This will happen only one thing is when there is diversity of food available, as I said. Secondly, it is also contingent on the conditions that allow absorption, such as sanitation facilities, such as health facilities, such as conditions that are clean and good atmosphere. So all these in a way become part of absorption of food, and then only the right to food gets realized. So you must have noticed that there are different forms or different ways through which right to food may get violated. So absence of any of these conditions may mean violation of right to food. And hence, because we have to ensure that there is absorption, there is utility, we also need to ensure that all these conditions are in place and a good environment is created. While we are talking about components or the constituents of right to food, we also need to ensure three more things. One thing is that these conditions should be continuous. That means that if these conditions are met only for a part of the year or only for a few months a year, that means the right to food is getting violated. When can that happen? You know, there is a large number or the large population of India grow their own food, who are farmers. And many of them are dependent on rains to come to grow their own food. When there are no rains, there's no food. So for them, right to food gets violated if they are not getting enough rains and when they are not able to eat enough food throughout the year. There can also be a possibility of somebody losing job or, you know, may not be able to be in a situation to buy his or her own food. So that means right to food is not getting realized in that particular country or state where he is in. So continuity is an important component of right to food. Next is the dignity component of it. You may think of a situation where all these conditions are met, enough quantity, quality, diversity of food is being available to somebody continuously without any break. But what could be one reason that may mean that that person's right is being violated? Dignity is a component that is very important when you're talking about food as a right. That means it should not be given as a dole or an assistance most of the time, but it should be available to human beings as a human right. In a family or in a state, if it is being given without dignity, that means there is a violation. A beggar's right to food does not get realized when he or she is begging and eating. Similarly, within a household, there can be social economic conditions or dynamics that may lead to violation of a dignified way of provision of food. And this is very much important when we are talking about gender dynamics within the family. Another important component of right to food is water. So right to food does not get realized if there is no water for somebody to drink. And that water should be safe for drinking, should be safe for personal use, and should also be available on a sustainable basis. Now, after understanding the theoretical and conceptual framework, which you must have seen is quite elaborate, we should also know that why do we talk about food as a right? Because it is such a common issue, a very simple term to understand, it's a very common part of our day-to-day life. It affects everyone, and everybody knows that we need food to eat on a regular basis. Then why do we actually need to conceptualize food as a right? Most importantly, right to food is the basis of realization of all other rights. All of you know that if you are hungry, if you have not eaten enough, or we have not eaten adequate food, or even if we have insecurity as regards, if we have eaten today but we are insecure about tomorrow's food, we will not be in a situation to exercise all other rights, whether it is civil and political rights or any other right. We will not go to vote if we have not eaten enough or we are hungry. We will not be able to participate in any other political process if food is not available, or food is not available on a regular basis, or we are insecure about it. Second reason why we need to talk about it is the fact that right to food by itself gets realized because of several other reasons and factors. The realization of right to food itself is dependent on many other conditions. We will talk about it. We need to have a conducive environment in terms of policy and law in the field of, say, agriculture, in the field of health, in the field of nutrition, in the field of employment, in the field of gender balance, in terms of economic access to resources, and many other fields that determine finally the realization of right to food. There is one more reason why we need to talk about food as a right. We know that India is now independent and has been growing sufficient food for consumption of its people. But there are still many people who are going hungry on a regular basis. Many of them are dying because of hunger and malnutrition. You must have heard in your state or in any other state that people are dying of starvation or because they couldn't eat. So these are the reasons that require us to talk about right to food. Another aspect of right to food is, or the food security that we talk about, is that the nature of how we consume food, how food is produced and made available, especially the status of food security, has changed over a period of time. If you know about famous famine of early 20th century, you will know that there are many people who died because of starvation. They didn't have enough food to eat. But now you will see that the nature of food insecurity has changed. Now, instead of acute starvation, that means non-availability of food for a long time, we will see more of chronic hunger. That means it's not that food is not available at all, but actually food is available, but that is not enough in terms of quantity, or the quality standards or the nutritive value does not match the standards. That means we have more of chronic hunger. People may die, you must have heard of malnutrition. That means they do not get all the nutrients that they require to live a healthy life. So that's also one of the reasons we need to ponder upon. In addition to that, we should also see that there are certain areas in the world who grow and have enough to eat, but there are other areas who do not have availability of enough food grains. You will also see that within India, there are certain regions or certain states, say Orissa or Bihar, where there are more of starvation deaths. But in other states, say Haryana and Punjab, that are not very far away situated, there are no starvation deaths as say because there is enough food which is available. So what do we mean by that? That means that food or hunger is not a problem of availability or food production. It is more of a problem of how food is distributed or food is transported to the areas where it should be made available. This becomes even more complex when we see the rising number of people who die every day of hunger. Globally, as indicated by International Food Policy Research Institute, there are some 815 million people across the world who die, and 2/3 of them live in developing countries. So it seems that's also related to not only growing food, but also how food is made available to these developing regions. India, unfortunately, has the largest number of hungry people in the world. It also has the largest number, in absolute term, of malnourished children in the world. In India, 39% of children are stunted. Stunting means a situation where the height deficit, it becomes so high that it goes beyond -2 standard deviation and it is irreversible. That means that after a child becomes stunted, he or she may not be able to catch up in his or her entire life with the height that he should have as per the norms indicated by Indian Council of Medical Research or any other norms that have been set by other such institutes. So this seems to be an alarming situation. In Global Hunger Index, for the past 5 or 6 years, India's rank has been really coming down. We started with 86th. This year, in 2018, we have come down to 102. Last year, we were at 100th rank. That means that as compared to other countries, we are not doing well enough in ensuring food for everyone on a regular basis. Coming to think of it, it's not that we have not improved our situation when it comes to right to food. Now, Global Hunger Index is constituted of some indicators that are very critical and in a way indicate the seriousness or the gravity of the problem related to food. It takes into account the number of people who are undernourished, children who are stunted, children who are wasted, that means who have low weight for their age, and infant mortality rates for a particular country. Now, these four indicators are central part of defining food security for all. So, if we are going down in the scale for these indicators, that means there is something really wrong in the way we define or in the way we operate our food security policies. Going down in the Global Hunger Index is not as simple as we may think. That doesn't mean that we are really not doing anything to ensure food for all. You must have heard about National Food Security Act, you must have heard about public distribution system, you also must have heard about meals being provided to children in schools. So it's not that nothing has been done, but the fact is that we are not doing well enough. We are not really catching up with other countries, and other countries are prioritizing their food security policies. They are investing more in health and nutrition, and we are not able to catch up with them. It's very unfortunate and distressing to see that we are worse off than our South Asian neighbors also. Bangladesh, for instance, is doing much better in terms of health and nutrition indicators. There are other countries such as Sri Lanka who have been much ahead of us. So we really need to look at why the situation has arisen. Before we look at what we have done or what is wrong with the food security policies or in their operationalization, I would like to mention a famous saying by a Nobel laureate, Amartya Sen and John Rees, who is a development economist, he said that to have enough food and food grains produced in a country and to have people dying of hunger and malnutrition is morally outrageous and politically unacceptable. So let us see what is that we need to do about ensuring that everybody has enough and good quality of food to eat. In order to understand where we have gone wrong, or in order to understand why there are so many hungry people in India and why the malnutrition rates are so high in India, we need to understand how actually the right to food gets realized. There are, I would say, three different ways or sources that help realization of right to food. For those who grow their own food, they need regular and sustainable access to the means of its production. That means they should have access to productive resources. And these are land, water, say credits, seeds, and irrigation facilities on a regular basis, and also electricity, for instance, for ensuring regular irrigation. So this is for those who are growing their own food, who are largely farmers, and they should be able to grow their own food only when these things are available. We also need to ensure agricultural infrastructure, access to markets and credits, as I said. There is a second category who does not grow their own food. There are people who buy their own food. So for them, they should be able to earn enough to be in a situation to purchase their own food. What is that we need to do for them? We need to ensure that education facilities are available. We need to make sure that quality education is being imparted. We need to ensure skill building and ensure that people are absorbed in the market. And we also need to ensure that there are enough employment opportunities created by the government for those who are not earning their food but are in a position to buy their food. The third way how right to food gets realized is for those who are neither growing their food nor they are in a situation to buy their food. These are the people who fall into the category of vulnerable groups, such as children or disabled or older people. Since they cannot do agriculture or they cannot go out for job to buy their own food, so for those people, it is the responsibility of the state to ensure that they are made part of safety nets and also schemes that are aimed at ensuring access to food and nutrition for them. After looking at the sources through which right to food get realized, we also need to look at how food security is different from right to food, or whether there is a difference between food security and right to food at all. We need to understand that food as a right has connotations that point towards a legislative framework. That means there should be a law that backs up the food security for all. In order to do that, we have to ensure that either there is a legislative framework that is there. That means that there's a framework law prepared. So it can be either one law ensuring food security, or there is a framework that is prepared and all the policies are aligned accordingly to ensure food security for all. And in addition to that, it needs to adhere to certain standards, certain norms that have been identified and recognized by international law, especially in terms of all the socio-economic and cultural rights. So if we have to ensure that a rights-based legal framework is adopted, there are certain principles we need to ensure to be included in that law. These principles are called as PANTHER principles. Each letter of PANTHER stands for a different principle that needs to be applied to a legislative framework when we are talking about food security for all, if it has to be a rights-based framework. P stands for participation. Participation of people, of those who are right holders, in determining what they need and what they want and how they would like to access it. So that's something that needs to be built into the law. A stands for accountability. Accountability of duty bearers, accountability of the government and state agencies and those who are in the position of implement the vision of the law. So they should be held accountable for the implementation. N stands for non-discrimination. That means that any provision that has been made in the law in terms of entitlements or any other benefits that are part of the law should be available to everyone without any discrimination. So there should not be any caste-based discrimination, there should not be any gender-based discrimination, no discrimination based on religion or any other economic or social factors. Now we come to T. T stands for transparency. That means that everything that has been done or discussed or being implemented, there should be transparency in that. People should be able to find out or should be able to know what exactly are the reasons, what is being provided and how they can access it. So there should be complete transparency in how governments function in provision of right to vote. There should not be any reason why there's anything which is kept out of the purview of transparency. In fact, in some of the cases, transparency should be done by the government itself without being asked for. Now we come to H. H stands for human dignity. As discussed in the part of conceptual understanding of right to food, we understand that human dignity is the integral part of a rights-based framework. So, when we are talking about human dignity for right to food, we are ensuring that any provision or any entitlement or any benefit that is being provided should be provided with dignity. Now we come to E. E means empowerment. When we are conceptualizing any law on or a legal framework on right to food, we must ensure that these provisions are empowering. These provisions, especially for those vulnerable groups, help empower themselves individually as well as a group and community. So any provisions that are leading to empowerment of beneficiaries are integral part of rights-based framework to food security. And the last but not the least, any legal framework or which is based on rights approach is incomplete if it doesn't have a recourse mechanism or a redressal mechanism. That means if my right as a right holder is being violated, I should be able to take a recourse mechanism. I should be able to file complaints. I should be able to go to the appropriate authority that should be designated or should be institutionalized as part of the law, and I should be able to file my complaints without any problems or without any hindrances, and there should be a procedure to redress my complaints. So these letters, or that means the word PANTHER, is actually a quite important component of right to food and stands for, as I said, various aspects of ensuring rights-based legal framework on food. Let us see now how legal framework has responded to the problem of violation of right to food, or how it has articulated the components or the constituents of food as a right. As I said in the beginning, food is such a common thing or a common aspect of our life that we don't even think that we need to make a separate legislative framework for that, for ensuring that everybody has right to food. And it was because of the same feeling that we see that initial human rights instruments did not articulate food as a right. Food was seen as part of either adequate standard of living or something that is very important for human survival, or as an environment that should be available to all without any discrimination. Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which is one of the earliest instruments of human rights law, mentioned food as part of adequate standard of living for people and should be available. It was in Article 25 that it was recognized that adequate standard of living should be ensured for all, and it was interpreted that food is an integral part of it. It was only in the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, in its Article 11, that everybody's right to be free from hunger was recognized and articulated very clearly. International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights also instituted the Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights to oversee the implementation of the Covenant and to monitor the implementation of the Covenant and its provisions in the member countries. Using its authority to ensure the implementation, the committee came up with several general comments. These general comments, as you might know, have helped defining and elaborating the content of the rights and have also in a way encouraged member countries to have procedures, to have institutions, legal frameworks to ensure economic, social and cultural rights. In the area of right to food, two general comments are very important that were made by the Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights. General Comment 12 elaborated on the content of right to food. It said that right to adequate food is realized when every man, woman and child, alone or in community with others, has physical, economic and social access to food at all times or means of its procurement. So it was quite an elaborate definition that was given through General Comment 12. General Comment 12 also said that there are certain obligations that are attached to the realization of right to food. That means states or the governments should respect, protect and fulfill these rights. Now, what do we mean by state respecting a right? It means that state should not get involved in any activity that may lead to the violation of that right. Protection means that state should be able to protect people from the third party interventions that may lead to violation of these rights. Respecting or fulfilling the right means that those who are vulnerable and those who cannot access or access the means for the realization of their rights, there should be specific provisions made for realization of their rights. In terms of right to food, when you look at it very closely, you will see that for those who are growing their own food, when state is respecting their right, it is ensuring that they have regular access to productive resources and state itself is not really getting involved in any activity that is depriving them of their land. When it comes to protection, that also means that if there is a private outfit or private company which may be perhaps trying to grab their land, it is the responsibility of the state to protect their right to food by protecting their land. In the same spirit, we need to understand the fulfillment obligation as well. That means provision and fulfillment of the right to food through state agencies by making welfare schemes or ensuring that all the people who are vulnerable are part of it. That was about General Comment 12. General Comment 15 of the Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights becomes very important when it comes to right to water. General Comment 15 specifically said that everybody should have access to sufficient, safe, acceptable, physically accessible water which is affordable. Water should be available for personal use as well as domestic use. For those who are into agriculture, they should be able to have sustainable access to water for agriculture. And General Comment 15 also said that state and state agencies should take specific care when it comes to the disadvantaged groups. General Comment 15 also said that state and state agencies should take special care when it comes to access to water for disadvantaged groups. That means there should not be no discrimination and there should be positive and constructive actions to be taken by state for ensuring that everyone without discrimination has access to water. In addition to Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, there are a few other conventions of the United Nations that are of specific importance when it comes to the right to food and nutrition. I would like to mention two important conventions that have direct bearing on right to food and health and nutrition for women and children. The first one being the United Nations Conventions on Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women. Article 12 particularly says the right of pregnant women to protection and adequate nutrition should be protected. It further says that rural women should have a specific right and access to land, credit, and other facilities that are required for them to carry on with their agriculture. United Nations Conventions on the Right of the Child, as you might know, is a very important international legal instrument for ensuring rights for the child. Article 25 particularly states the right of highest unalienable standard of health for all the children. Article 27 specifically says the right to adequate standard of living, including food and nutrition, are important part of children's right to food. So these two conventions, in addition to Universal Declaration of Human Rights and Convention on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, form the crux of international legal instruments that are important when it comes to realization of right to food. After looking at our international obligations, we also need to see what we as a country have done to ensure right to food for everyone through a legislative action. There are different components while talking about the legal framework on right to food in India. First is definitely the Constitution of India. We need to see whether there are any specific provisions made to ensure food security. Secondly, we need to see if there is a policy that is in place. We also need to look at whether there are schemes and programs for those who are vulnerable, and whether there is a law that exists to ensure food security for everyone. In addition to that, we also should be able to see what role judiciary has played in evolving the jurisprudence on right to food in India. I must mention here that judiciary in India has played a pivotal role in expanding the scope, articulation of entitlements, and ensuring food security for everyone in India. And India is seen as a case study by other countries when it comes to the role of courts in defining and ensuring right to food for everyone. Let us look at now how Constitution of India responds to the need of ensuring right to food for all. You must be familiar with Directive Principles of State Policy and Fundamental Rights. In the section of Directive Principles of State Policy, Article 39 requires the state to take measures to ensure right to food, health and nutrition for all children. Article 47 again emphasizes the need to take special measures for ensuring better standard of living for all its citizens. So in a way, food security, nutrition and right to food seem to be part of these two provisions if we interpret them progressively. Talking about the fundamental rights and the right to food, we must know that Article 21, though mentions right to life, but does not get interpreted as right to food. Now, why that is the case? Commonly speaking, right to food cannot get realized unless we have food. However, when the matter was taken to the court in the Supreme Court of India, this contention was never resolved, and the court never said that right to food is part of right to life. We will talk about how court has responded to the situation of hunger and malnutrition a little later. However, Directive Principles of State Policy provide us with enough order to understand that health and nutrition are integral part of Directive Principles of State Policy, and it is the responsibility of the state to take measures for ensuring food security and nutrition for all, especially for children. In the spirit of Directive Principle of State Policy, there were several schemes and programs that were initiated by the Government of India as well as various state governments. Public distribution system, as you might have heard of, has a history of a pre-independence era. It was started much before independence and it continues to exist in its different form even today. Public distribution system operates through Food Corporation of India and fair price shops that are established for distribution of grains on subsidized rates. In 1990s, this public distribution system was converted into targeted public distribution system. That means not everybody was entitled or not everybody was a beneficiary for this scheme. That also means that only few people were targeted to provide the benefits that were available through the scheme. In most cases, or most of the time, food grains, pulses, sugar, kerosene oil, and few other condiments have been part of provisions that have been included or being distributed to people, especially to poor people, through targeted public distribution system. In addition to public distribution system that was universal and later made targeted system of public distribution, there are other schemes that are focused on marginalized sections and especially poor people of India. Antyodaya Anna Yojana is one such scheme that includes the provision of 35 kgs of grains per month to poorest of the poor families. There are certain other schemes that are focused only on children. You must have heard of noon meals being provided to children through midday meal scheme program of the government. That means that all children who are in government schools or in government schools are entitled to get free meals every day while in school. Integrated Child Development Scheme is another such scheme that focuses on younger children and pregnant women and lactating mothers. It has provision for nutrition, early childhood education, immunization, health checkups, referrals, as well as counseling to be done for adolescent girls and pregnant and lactating mothers. There are different entitlements or the benefits that are to be provided to different age groups of children. For children between 6 months to 3 years, there is take-home ration that is available. And children between 3 to 6 are supposed to come to an integrated child development service center, which is known as Anganwadi, for nutrition and early childhood education. In addition to these programs, you also must have heard about people's right to work. Through Food for Work program, initially Government of India started a scheme in which, in lieu of the work done by people, food grains were distributed. After many, many years, National Rural Employment Guarantee Act came into being and this program was converted into a legal entitlement through which wages are provided to people in rural areas in lieu of the work that they do in rural areas. Apart from that, there are two more schemes that are relevant in this context. One is the old age pension that is meant to provide social security to people who are old and not able to earn their living. Second one being maternity entitlement schemes. These schemes have been known by different names in different states and some of them have been centrally sponsored schemes. Janani Suraksha Yojana, through which cash was used to be provided to women only in the case of institutional deliveries, is one such scheme. There is another scheme which is called Indira Gandhi Matritu Sahyog Yojana that was started as pilot projects in few districts and through which cash entitlements were provided. The latest one being Pradhan Mantri Matritu Vandana Yojana, through which a cash entitlement of ₹4,000 to ₹5,000 is provided to pregnant women at the time of delivery or in the installments to be decided by state governments. So these are some of the schemes and some of the programmatic interventions that were taken up by Government of India to ensure food security of all. These schemes are also important because these schemes were identified by the judiciary, by Supreme Court of India, as forerunners for ensuring food security and ensuring right to food for everyone. All these schemes that I mentioned just now were started at different points in time to ensure food security and right to food for different groups of people who were vulnerable or who required state support. But it was only in 1993 that India came up with a policy for ensuring food security and nutrition for all. This policy was known as National Nutrition Policy. This policy was based on situational analysis, was based on the fact that though we are producing enough food grains, but food is not being distributed evenly or as per the requirement of the people, and also on the basis of identification of factors that go into creating the situation of food insecurities and hunger. This piece of document was quite comprehensive, based on an intersectoral and integrated approach of all the sectors that have implications on food security, as we were discussing earlier. So it came up with a comprehensive set of plan for ensuring food security for everyone. It included indirect interventions and direct interventions that are required to be made for ensuring food security for all. But most importantly, what it did was is establishing a kind of framework within which we need to look at food insecurity. Because it was the first policy document, it was important to see that is established the connection, the association between poverty, low productivity, less food, and then again low productivity, and the cycle that goes on. The comprehensive understanding of food security and its various aspects went into also defining various indirect and direct interventions that were required to be taken for ensuring food security for all. In terms of direct interventions, the policy specifically recommended that there should be specific schemes that should be in place, such as ICDS, specific interventions to be made for ensuring that food is available to vulnerable groups such as adolescent girls and young children. It also said that there should be provision of administering micronutrients to young children and those who fall into the category which is more susceptible to micronutrient deficiencies. It also said that various schemes should be in place for ensuring provision of direct food and food grains to the groups that are in the areas in distress, especially drought-prone areas. It also recommended fortification of food and staple food grains to ensure that all the micronutrients are absorbed by the population. This policy defined malnutrition as a population issue and not an issue that is only related to an individual or a community or a section of the society. It established that if malnutrition and food insecurities continue to exist, these are going to impact the health profile of the country and eventually the national growth and development of the entire nation. In terms of indirect intervention, it suggested that there is a need for diversification of public distribution system. That means it should not only be wheat and rice that should be available, but all other things that are required that go into cooking our food should be made available to people through a public distribution system. It was very encouraging to see that the policy also talked about land reforms to be done so that farmers are not at the disadvantage of losing any income or they continue to be part of food security systems. The policy also suggested that nutrition surveillance needs to be done through agencies such as National Nutrition Monitoring Bureau or National Institute of Nutrition to ensure that no child falls into the category of severe and acute malnutrition. Very important aspect of the policy was recognition of the fact that equality and gender empowerment are integral part if we want to ensure food security for all. It recommended that equal wages to be provided for same work. It also recommended that measures need to be taken for ensuring empowerment of women, and there should also be community participation in the decisions that are taken for ensuring food security for all, as well as raising awareness among people on various aspects of food, on nutrition, and for that, effective communication needs to be done to the community directly so that they understand various aspects of food security, nutrition, whether it is how they are going to access their entitlements or it is technical knowledge about nutrition and how it can be ensured for various age groups. So this was about the National Nutrition Policy that I said was a comprehensive piece of document, dealt with almost all the aspects that have direct or indirect bearing on right to food. Now let us look at where we went from 1993 to ensuring food security. Despite a national nutrition policy in place and sufficient production that was enabled through Green Revolution, we continued to see hunger deaths in the country. We continued to see rising number of malnourished children, and we also continued to see various other forms of violations that were there, especially in terms of food. food security for vulnerable groups. It was in 2001 that a petition was filed initially in the High Court of Rajasthan by public-spirited citizens, which was later taken up by People's Union on Civil Liberties and was recognized by Supreme Court of India. There were two major contentions in this petition. One was that food grains are available and in fact are rottening in the godowns of Food Corporation of India and people are dying of hunger and malnutrition, especially in the times of drought. The second one was that right to food is part of right to life as defined in Article 21 and should be recognized as a fundamental right by the court. Reflecting on these two contentions, Supreme Court of India utilized this opportunity to use its power of continuous mandamus. That means that the court did not settle immediately that whether or not right to life includes right to food as Article 21, but went on in defining the content of right to food. What the court did was, it gave specific recommendations to central and state governments to implement the provisions of the schemes that I was mentioning earlier, because the state governments and the central government said that they have come up with all these schemes to ensure food security for all, and hence they have played the role that was required to be played by a welfare government. Supreme Court said that if these schemes are in place, then these schemes should be implemented properly. There should be a proper implementation mechanisms, and these schemes should be as far as possible made universal for everybody to access. Supreme Court issued several interim orders to ensure that these schemes are implemented adequately. In addition to providing immediate relief to those who were aggrieved and giving directions to the government, Supreme Court's role in articulating the content of entitlement was very important. For instance, Supreme Court said that there is no reason to deprive children from midday meals during summer vacations, especially in drought-prone areas. Now, we knew that midday meals were provided to children during the school days, but in drought-prone areas with no meals during summer vacations, they were going hungry. So, Supreme Court identified this as an issue and Supreme Court directed the state governments to ensure that meals are provided to children during summer vacations as well, especially in drought-prone areas. Similarly, the court said that integrated child development scheme should be available universally in areas where the access is a problem. There should be mini Anganwadis should be set up. The court also said that in setting up of Anganwadis, tribal areas should be prioritized. There are several such other interim orders that were given by Supreme Court of India that ensured that all the aspects of food security and nutrition specifically for vulnerable groups are taken care of. Going beyond what the court also did was, it instituted a monitoring mechanisms. Supreme Court in PUCL versus Union of India case instituted Supreme Court commissioners, those who were supposed to monitor the implementation of the orders given by Supreme Court bench in this case. There is another thing that was done to ensure implementation of these orders at state level. There were state advisors that were instituted in all the states to ensure that these orders are being adhered to and are being implemented. So these monitoring mechanisms as well as the entitlements that were articulated provided a sound basis for ensuring food security, which later in a way should have informed a legal framework for right to food for everyone. Very recently in 2017, this case was closed by the Supreme Court of India on the grounds that there is now a National Food Security Act and the court does not have any jurisdiction to give any orders on this subject. It also failed to recognize conclusively right to food as part of right to life as mentioned in Article 21. So now National Food Security Act, which was passed in the year 2013, has is seen as a legally binding and a legal instrument for ensuring right to food for everyone in the country. So let us look at now what Food Security Act deals with and what are its various components. In order to understand National Food Security Act, we can perhaps divide its various components into different sections. The most important is its preamble, I would say. In its preamble, National Food Security Act defines as its objective to ensure food and nutrition security to all in a life cycle approach. Now, what does that mean? Life cycle approach means that each individual at various stages of his or her life had different needs in terms of food and nutrition, and hence, in the objective of National Food Security Act, it's clearly mentioned that age appropriate food and nutrition should be made available to all, and this is the responsibility of the state as mentioned in National Food Security Act. When we go through the rest of the components of National Food Security Act, we will see that it has a number of entitlements mentioned in various sections. It also has an elaborate monitoring mechanism. It also includes grievance redressal mechanism, which is quite elaborate and comprehensive. And there are schedules that in a way quantify the entitlements that are relating to the substantial sections of National Food Security Act. Section 3 to 6 of National Food Security Act are quite important because all the entitlements that are part of the Act are mentioned in these sections. Section 3, through Targeted Public Distribution System, National Food Security Act makes a provision for 5 kgs of food grains to the poor people of India. Now, these food grains are available for 75% of rural population and 50% of urban population, and these 5 kg grains are provided per person per family. How the identification of this 75% rural and 50% of urban population will be done is entirely up to the respective state governments. The second entitlement in the Act is midday meal scheme. The Act says that hot cooked meals will be provided to all children up to the age of 14 years of government and government aided schools. They can be provided either up to 14 years or can be provided till 8th standard. In a way, children above 8th standard are not within the purview of this benefit. The Act also converts some of the provisions of integrated child development schemes into legal entitlements. It makes provision of nutrition support to children in the age group of 6 months to 6 years. It also makes provision of nutrition support to pregnant and lactating mothers and makes additional support to be provided to malnourished children. Now, these provisions are to be implemented through ICDS centers, that is Anganwadis. The next important entitlement is the cash entitlement of Rs 6,000 to pregnant and lactating mothers that has been made in the Act. There is another important and interesting aspect of the Act which has been mentioned in Section 8 of the Act. Section 8 of the Act says that those who are not able to get prescribed quantity of food grains or entitlements as mentioned in Article 3 to 6, they are entitled to Food Security Allowance that is to be provided by state governments and will be determined in the way it will be provided by the central government. So that means if I as an individual not able to get my entitlement, I am entitled to food security allowance that should be provided by the government. So these are in nutshell some of the entitlements that have formed part of the National Food Security Act. TPDS or the Targeted Public Distribution System is to be operated through fair price shops. Midday meals are to be provided in government and government aided schools. ICDS is to operate through Anganwadis, and with this institutional mechanisms, these entitlements are to be provided to people who are the beneficiaries of the Act. In addition to these entitlements, the Act also, as I said, mentions elaborate monitoring mechanisms and grievance redressal mechanisms. In terms of monitoring mechanisms, Section 28 says that state and state agencies should either conduct or pause to conduct social audits. Social audit is a form of community-based monitoring that needs to be done for all the schemes as mentioned in the Act. There's another institute that has been established, or is supposed to be established through the Act, which are called vigilance committees. Section 29 of the Act mentions that vigilance committees are supposed to be constituted at fair price shop level, block level, district level, and state level for the monitoring of all the schemes that are mentioned in the Act. These vigilance committees are to be composed with representation of women and other socially marginalized groups, such as scheduled castes in the area. A very important part of the Act is the grievance redressal mechanism that has been mentioned in the Act. The Act prescribes three-tier system of grievance redressal. That means those who are not able to get the benefits as mentioned in the Act can approach any of these mechanisms for ensuring that they get their benefits. The first one being internal grievance redressal mechanism. By the nomenclature itself, is to be instituted within the respective departments that is responsible for provision or implementation of particular provisions. So that may include having helplines, complaint boxes, or certain mechanisms to be made for accepting complaints, such as nodal officers, or any other such means through which complaints can be made by aggrieved persons very conveniently. The second important grievance redressal mechanism as prescribed in the Act is the provision of district grievance redressal officer that has been mentioned in section 15 of the Act. This district grievance redressal officer, or DGRO, is supposed to be either designated or appointed by state government in each district to look at monitor the implementation of the Act and to receive complaints. But most important grievance redressal mechanism mentioned in the Act is the provision of state food commissions. You must have heard the provisions of child rights commissions or women's commissions or SCST commissions that have been made for these particular groups to file their complaints, and these commissions then look into these matters and advise the governments in implementation of particular laws, or advising the governments for ensuring that the protection of rights of these particular groups is done. Similarly, state food commissions are supposed to be established in each state by the state governments to monitor the implementation of National Food Security Act and all the schemes mentioned in that, and also advise the state government for ensuring that the implementation of the Act is done in a progressive manner. Anybody who has any complaints, any aggrieved person whose right is being violated, anybody who is not able to access the entitlement as mentioned in the Act can go to these commissions and file their complaints. In addition to these entitlements, monitoring mechanisms, and grievance redressal mechanisms, National Food Security Act also talks about reforms in targeted public distribution system. That means if there is a need for transparency, if there is a need to ensure that there is no wastage, if there is a need to use technology in efficient manner, all that needs to be done. One important feature of the Act is that the responsibility of implementation of the entire Act, most of it, lies with the state government, and central government's role is limited in that sense. National Food Security Act also makes provision for transparency and accountability of the state and its agency. It requires all the state government to display all the information pertaining to provisions, implementation of the Act, either through websites or on the service delivery points. And that is an important component, as we were talking, that accountability is an important aspect for ensuring rights-based implementation of food security. One can say that there is a lot that has been achieved through National Food Security Act. Many provisions that were there, that were available earlier through various schemes, or some of them were even converted into legal entitlements by the interventions made by the judiciary, were in fact identified as legal entitlements that are enforceable in the court of law. It also instituted monitoring and grievance redressal mechanism for those who were not able to access, and also generated a lot of interest among people, being the federal or central law that was brought about by the central government. However, there are many issues that remain unresolved. There are many counts on which the Act failed to come up to the aspiration of people. If we go back in the history, we must know that there is a lot of public aspiration that is attached to any social legislation that comes into being after a long struggle. When in 2009, United Progressive Alliance, in its election manifesto, declared that if UP comes into government, they will come up with a food security law. And when later the President of India declared that a central law will be brought about to ensure food security for all, a lot of individuals, organizations, movements came together to reflect on what should be actually the content of this law. Because food security, as we were discussing earlier, is a multifaceted concept. And we need to look at several aspects if we want to frame a law. However, when the law finally came into being in 2013, it dealt with only few of the aspects of food security. It did not deal with the production issue. It did not deal with the discrimination issue. It failed to look at the nutritional aspect of the population. All it did was, in addition to converting some of the provisions of the schemes into legal entitlements, was to provide a legal handhold to people who were not able to get it. It was based on a narrow understanding of food security and dealt with only the distribution part of it, that too in a limited way. Coming to the targeted public distribution system, the Act left the responsibility of identifying the beneficiaries to the state governments. Now, how it will be done and who will be beneficiaries, that was entirely left to the state government's discretion. What are the problems that have arisen because of that? We must also know that the 75% of rural population and 50% of urban population coverage is only at the All India level. All the state governments are supposed to identify respective number of people from rural population and urban population to provide them the benefits as mentioned in National Food Security Act. There have been a lot of glitches, there have been a lot of problems with this identification. There are states that have been struggling to reach that magical number to ensure that only that much percentage of people are covered. States like Rajasthan have changed their criteria for identification for as many as 11 times, only to ensure that only that much number is covered. In some of the states, the total coverage of public distribution system has come down post National Food Security Act because they were covering earlier a larger number of people. So there are many issues that have cropped up. National Food Security Act is also criticized because of this lopsided view of food security. A lot of concentration has been done on public distribution system and not a lot of importance has been given to other schemes such as midday meals and ICDS and maternity entitlements as well. One instance, as I mentioned, the Act says that reforms should be introduced to target the public distribution system, but the Act does not mention that there is also need to reform other schemes that are important. There were several entitlements as articulated by the Supreme Court of India in PUCL versus Union of India case, but all of them have not found in National Food Security Act. We also know that many state governments had gone beyond the scheme purviews and had initiated several other programs or had made several other interventions to ensure food security for all. Karnataka, for instance, had already extended midday meals to children up to 10th standard, and Tamil Nadu, for instance, had almost universalized the targeted public distribution system. National Food Security Act and its provisions are in a way discouraging for all these states to continue with all these entitlements. There is also an interesting section which is called force majeure, which is mentioned in section 44 of the Act. It says that if in any case the governments, whether it's state government or central government, are failing to provide food and food grains in the respective quantity and quality as per the Act, But if it is because of any natural disaster, or it's called as God, act of God, any natural disaster such as drought, famine, or fire, or any such incidents, then state governments or central government will not be liable to provide those benefits. Now, if we think of it, we know that in those kind of conditions, even people who are privileged to get regular supply of food grains will also require additional support. So what is actually the intention behind including this section? Schedule 3 of the Act is a very progressive, a very comprehensive part of the Act, which relates to Section 31 of the Act. Section 31 says that some of the objectives will be progressively realized, and these objectives are mentioned in Schedule 3. Now, what exactly is the content of Schedule 3? Agricultural reforms, credits and irrigation facilities to farmers, securing sufficient incomes for farmers, remunerative prices, safe drinking water, health facilities, adolescent health, all these have been made part of Schedule 3, which are supposed to be progressively realized. But as we were discussing in the conceptual framework of a comprehensive food security and right to food, we know that all these are integral part of right to food. That means National Food Security Act fails to protect right to food for everyone in a comprehensive manner. We also should know that if the law has to go beyond its regulatory role and has to play a role in social transformation, it has to capture the public aspiration and should be comprehensive to deal with the contemporary problems. So if we need to ensure realization of right to food, that means we have to make the provisions that are progressive, that are comprehensive, and are dealing with all the issues that National Food Security Act fails to deal with. We may perhaps need to look at a legal framework which is, if not alternative, then comprehensive enough to encompass all these aspects. I thank all of you for your patience, for listening to me so carefully.